Hi, good afternoon. Thank you for having me here. What we believe at the organization I represent, which is the Timbuktu Collective, is that eco-restoration is just one small part of what we have to do and what we need to do. And the organization, the Timbuktu Collective, is based in Andhra Pradesh, in a very dry and arid region. It receives a very low rainfall. Used to be a very famous place at one point, with the Vijayanagara kingdom being there, and now is where you hear about farmer suicides. So the status now is not so great. Next. This is a typical example of where I come from, Rayalaseema. Denuded hills, overgrazed, agriculture is rain-fed, which means a lot, and you can see a little bit of greenery in the stream sometimes, but that's the kind of landscape, yeah, next. So the organization has a strange name, Timbuktu, but it has an interesting name as well. I won't get into that. But it was basically an experiment started by a couple of activists back in the 90s. And they bought a piece of land and tried some eco-restoration on it. There was a small little hut we have very, for the architects in the room, there's it's very simple, basic, low-cost design. Next. And our vision is basically to get people to govern themselves and feel proud of what they do. Next. And we like to work with a certain community of people, usually the most marginalized, because that's where we feel the need to work is. And also, people need to be happy and joyous in their home, which is the rural landscape of Rayalaseema. Next. So how do we go about doing that? We have a strategy, and this entails working with a number of different people in the community. So it would be women, it would be children, a whole bunch of people. And we try and reinvent the local economy, actually, because it's been destroyed, and regenerate the ecology. And we work through the cooperative model. So we promote cooperatives, sustainable rural cooperatives. Next, please. Some of the interventions we have, there's the work with women, there's work with people with disabilities, there's work with children and youth, then there's sustainable farming, organic farming, then there's the ecologic restoration work, and then there's a whole bunch of business enterprises, which is community-owned, community-run, and community-led. Next, please. So the women's cooperative, next, started off very small, and with just a few, you know, women saving maybe 10, 20 rupees a month, because what they needed at that point was they needed access to money. They didn't have much money for them to do anything. So that's how it started. And next, started with a lot of meetings, talking to people, getting to figure out what they really want. Next. And as of today, we've been quite successful with that project, and we have about 20,000 women in that. And we cover about 170 villages. And as you can see, all the money here, it's about 18 crores, which is quite a bit of money. And it's all local money. It's not that we've taken money in from outside. It's not microfinance where you borrow money at a lower rate and then have to give it back to someone outside. This is people's money. It's those women who have saved those 10, 20 rupees. Yeah. Next. So again, this is an example of a thrift meeting that they're having. Next. Coming to the children's group, again, it's great if children have a safe and nice place to be. And we try and do that. Please, next. So we broadly work in three different works. We have a school. We have Mogga, which is an outreach program, where we have sanghas, which is formations of youth children groups in the villages. And we also have resource centers across the three mandals, which is the district administrative boundaries that we have. So kids who are not part of these sanghas can come to these centers. There's books and there's things like that, facilities for them. Next. Yeah, next. So they do a whole bunch of activities, which is fun. It's most of it is outside of their school time, so they get a lot of extracurricular activities. Yeah, next, please. This is the work with people with disabilities. Most of this work is somewhat advocacy work, where we try and leverage a lot of the government schemes with the people with disabilities at a disadvantage to get those, so they don't necessarily get access to those. And then we have our own, next. We have some of our own initiatives, which is the therapy and rehabilitation, and also a thrift component. And this cooperative is also starting a business enterprise. Next. So this is some of the work with the kids. Next. Next. Yeah, so farming, we work with organic farmers. This again is interesting because it came out, it's one of our later things we started doing later on. When we were working with the women's cooperative, the women were taking huge loans. And that's why they had this need for money as well. And then we tried to get to the story of why they're taking those loans. And they were taking the loans to buy pesticides and chemicals and things for their chemical farming. So they're taking maybe 70,000, a lakh and 50. And then there'd be a drought and they wouldn't be able to pay it back. So we thought, okay, instead of, we need to address that issue of why they're taking those loans. Because organic farming, the way we've been looking at it, most of your material, I mean, you guys know about organic farming because most, like you were saying earlier, someone was saying, it happens here. So with this, farming was started by the women's cooperative in some sense. The women were the funders behind our organic farming, which is largely men, but they gave the initial seed money and the loan, and they were part of the ideation of this process. Next. This is some of the what we call kashayams, which are the mixtures, organic mixtures. They use a whole bunch of different things. Yeah, next. This is a farmer field school where you have to, I mean, people have forgotten, unfortunately. People used to be organic farmers. Everyone, these guys, some of their parents were organic farmers, so they were the experts, but unfortunately, those skills have been lost. So now we try and reconnect them to what they actually knew. So it's a school to kind of let them learn organic. Yeah. So now we come to the producer enterprises, because what we are finding is that there's only so much grant money you can raise and leverage, and for long-term sustainability of a project, you need to be able to create some kind of revenue model, and you might have to engage with the market. Next. So the Dharani Farm Cooperative, we sell under the brand name called Timbuktu Organic, and it's basically the farmers cooperative, which is about 1,500 members, bring their produce, and they're also doing pretty okay. I think they're about 14 crores now, which is good. We also promote millets, which is a dryland crop. So we try and do, we grow only crops that are local to that area. Next, please. Why would someone want to do organic farming? There's a whole bunch of reasons, but these are some of the few things that why a cooperative works and why the farmers are willing to sell to the Dharani cooperative. Is because they actually don't get cheated. They get fair prices. They're the owners of the same company. So your farmer is your owner. And I think it works for them. Yeah. Next. And of course, there's a lot of work created because of the processing. We do a lot of, we don't use so many machines. We do a lot of the cleaning of the, say, the millets by hand. So labor is also created in this process. Next, please. Brahmacharis work with landless laborers. So there were some of the people left out with the other initiatives. So we have a sheep and goat rearing work with them. They're also now slowly getting involved with our restoration work. They, because they use the common lands, the grazing lands. Next. And like if you look at that graph, you see in about 2011-12, it got a bit worrying and they weren't making money and you know what was gonna happen, but we stuck with it and we're lucky to have funders also believed that it would work. And I think the data from this year will be even better. So in some sense, it's good to just, if you have an idea, you back it and stick with it. It takes a while to get it going. Next. This is our initiative with the young women in the village. It's to revive khadi, and it's the complete process from actually spinning to dyeing to weaving and also selling it. Yeah. Next. And the people with disabilities do have the soap enterprise. So basically each of our programs, which we can have enterprise related to it, we're trying to do that, except of course the school and education one where you can't. Next. Coming to the restoration part. So again, restoration, and I'm gonna talk about community-led restoration. So this is working with rural people. This is one of our restoration sites. We have about 9,000 acres. So it's pretty large, it's vast. So these are community common lands, which belong to the people in the village. And these were all denuded and pretty, like I think Ketaki's presentation had a lot of the slides of how bad it can be. There was nothing here. All these trees have grown back, all that grass, like she was talking about pioneer species of grass and other grass species. These are all new. These are only because of restoration. And when we do protection, it's we don't really fence because we're talking about too large a land area. So that's where, now it goes back to a women's cooperative, work with farmers, work with people with disabilities. you can actually do community fencing. Because you can talk to people and say, listen, this is what we're trying to do, and people buy into that. So how do you go about doing that? Next. So that's one of our community forest watchers, trying to, what the term is, a parabiologist, where you get local people to also do a lot of the data collection and things. So how do you get communities to restore wildlife? I mean, it'll take a while to figure that out, but I'll just try and give you a brief overview. Next. You start with an example, and this is the example. Actually, we don't have a picture from earlier on, so there's already quite a bit of restoration that's happened because, but you can kind of make out. So that's the Timbuktu Collective Campus. That's 33 acres of private land, but we worked on the hills as well. And on that side, you can see. So with this example that was in place, it made it a lot easier for us to go out into the villages and say, okay, come on, let's try and restore some of your lands, and you can come and see what's happened in our backyard. And that's how it started. Next, please. So it's a lot of community mobilization. These are old pictures from a long time ago where there was a lot of discussions with the community, talks about how you can go about doing this. And it started with one village, with about 15 people of a certain community in that village who decided to say, okay, after about a year of persuasion, to do this. And they managed to conserve about 150 acres of land. And one year, they saw a huge difference. And the people from the next village came the next year and cut down some of their trees and took some of their fodder. And that led to a fight. The positive outcome of the fight was that the community who had done the conservation were angry. They put a fine on this community who came in. So the community came in, came back to us and said, okay, listen, since we're not being allowed to take these guys' fodder, let's also do this conservation. So we then started working with one village and then the next. Next, please. It involves a lot of work with teachers, with facilitators, so it's not that I'm running around doing all this work. We need to really get it out to a lot of other people. So here's some of our teachers learning how to use binoculars and do bird watching and have fun themselves, which they can then take that energy to young people. Next. And end of the day, like, I ask myself, why am I a wildlife biologist? What has led me to it? And it's basically, I spent a lot of time doing this, just jumping around streams and, you know, looking at frogs and having a good time outdoors. And if we can't do that with our kids, whether they're from the city or in the rural area, we're not going to be able to conserve anything. So it's great. It's very important that children are taken outdoors and they have a good experience there. Next. Of course, like Ketuki was showing, education material, especially in the local language, very important. We have a lot of material in English, usually, and it has to be quite simple. It doesn't need to have sort of purposely left out scientific names, because you don't want kids confused over that. But you need to get it in the local language. That's the main thing. We have a lot of information, birds of India, birds of this, mammals of that, all in English. So we're leaving out a huge proportion of our people from that. Next, please. More meetings with the community. You have to spend a lot of time. We have, you know, it's a constant engagement. Next. Formation of VFCs, which are basically village forest committees. So then so you have this large discussion with everybody, and then you figure out, okay, who's really going to get involved with the conservation work. And you form these smaller groups, and these groups meet every month, and staff go out and discuss with them and things. Next. Exposure visits, that's a great way to do it, because you see other places which have done restoration work or other places which are really denuded. It's great for people to go out and have a look at where things are going on in other places. Next. Figuring out who's going to actually do the groundwork. So we have community forest watchers, so similar to what the forest department has, but this is community-led. So we have about 11 forest watchers for about the 9,000 acres. And they actually do the patrolling. They have little huts where they take rest and shelter in the summer. Next, please. That's Shiva. He's out looking. He's really good with this stuff. He knows what's going on. So he patrols. He goes around figuring out, okay, if someone's poaching, if someone's overgrazing, someone is, you know, taking something they shouldn't be doing or doing something illegal, or windmills. There's a lot of development projects that put pressure on the conservation area. So our watchers are the first line of actually figuring out what's going on. And they also do the data collection. Thanks. Next. Yeah. Shepherds, very important, one of the biggest stakeholders in this whole process. And we're talking about, okay, so if you go and plant an area, if you go and put in saplings there, the shepherds come in the next day and it's all gone. Talk to people, show them you have no ulterior motive, that we're working together, and we can fence a huge area with community fencing. You talk to shepherds, say, okay, listen, why, just keep your sheep out of here, and you have the watchers there. It's a bit of balance between two things. Seems to work. Next. Demarcation, so it's not fences, but it's just a few boards here and there, and there's this kind of signboards demarcating the area so that people know what's the conservation area and what's not. Next. Fire. One of the biggest things is grazing and fire, the two biggest issues when you're trying to restore a place. But fire is also important, but sometimes, I mean, in grassland ecosystems, fire is important, but the regularity of it and how intense it is and what season it's the fires are at is crucial. So we make fire lines, and slowly now I'm trying to get into controlled burning. I haven't done it as yet, but I'm trying to figure out with the community how we do that. So this also serves as an outreach activity for young people, because they come out, they get to learn, you know, it's crazy work, but they have fun doing it. Next. Seed collection, native seeds. So if you have a place with where you want to restore, you have a place which has a lot of the seeds, you collect some of it. Next. You store it for a short while in the storeroom, and then you take it out and plant it in different areas. Next, yeah. These camps for actually planting those seeds again turn out into an educational activity because children get involved. So young people also, and even the other people from the community come up and they spend some time doing this seed dibbling. Yeah, next. Some of the basic soil and water conservation work that needs to be done. This is all watershed management stuff. Next. So check dams and things like this. Yeah, next. Then the actual planting. So some of the saplings, yeah. Next. Now, one important component is research and monitoring. Unfortunately, in India, it's the other way around at the moment. People do less conservation and more research and monitoring, at least the scientists. So we're trying to do more conservation and doing a little bit of research. So that's a camera trap that Shiva and Abhik setting up a camera trap, trying to figure out what wildlife has gone past. Next. Bit of mapping and GIS, so you know what you're getting into and you have a kind of larger perspective. And of course, you know that you're protecting the watershed. That's the Mushtikoila watershed. That's one of our conservation patches. That's about 5,000 acres of land. Next. So one of the important things is that this area provides livelihood opportunities for rural communities. Otherwise, people also won't conserve it. So it's a balanced, it's a mixed use kind of system. So here you can see the thatch grass, which people collect every year. Next. A lot of sheep go in there, but we still have our wildlife and it's still in pretty good shape. Next. You have all these different things. So this is broom grass. People make a living out of that. Yeah, next. Fruits, some of the non-timber forest produce fruits. Next. Biodiversity value, next. We have a lot of Schedule 1 species, so interesting birds and mammals, next. Medicinal plants, next. Birds, I was saying, next. So just looking at a species accumulation curve, which means it's still climbing, so that as I go and do more surveys, I'm going to have more birds being found in this area. Next. Provides an important wildlife corridor, so that little part there you see is the conservation area between two reserve forests, and all that pink stuff you see is human use, heavy human use. So if I was an animal, I'd more likely use this area than go through that. Next. Indian gray wolf. We are one of the few community conserved areas which has a species like that on the land. Next. Just an example of the savanna part of the ecosystem, and this is the forest, more the forest patch. So we have kind of two distinct landscapes. Next. Yeah, thank you.